Hi, New Life family. I want to welcome you to our online services this weekend, but a couple of things I want to share with you before we begin our worship. First, you'll notice that we have moved from the living room into our worship center here on our Turlock campus. For us, this is kind of a next stage transition as we move closer to regathering in person. For those of you who attend our Patterson campus, we're still waiting on the school district calendar to see what the next stage is. But for both campuses, the truth is we're just not there yet. And I'm going to be talking about that more in the message, so just hang on. But I hope this move into our worship center will feel a little more like being back. Second, I want us to pause today and pray before we begin and acknowledge all that's been going on around us. I also want you to know that I will probably say this imperfectly, but I'm asking that you would extend some grace and that you would hear my heart in this, because my heart is heavy right now. We're weary and wrung out from COVID-19, and on the heels of that, we find ourselves grieving at what we see going on in our country, but also in our communities, the racism and the senseless tragic killing, the violence, the injustice, the hate, and the polarization. We're hurting and grieving with the Black community and our brothers and sisters of color. In addition, we feel the loss that businesses and business owners, both large and small, are experiencing due to the vandalism and the arson and the looting. Jesus said in John 10:10 that our enemy, Satan, comes to steal and kill and destroy, but that Jesus came to give us life. Now notice who the enemy is. It's Satan, not each other. So today we're going to go to the one who we know can change hearts. We're going to go to the one who gives us life, and we're going to pray right now for his life-changing power to sweep through our nation and our communities and actually our very own hearts. So would you pray with me? Father, we come to you today and our hearts truly are heavy and grieving. We see what's happening in the world, and we hurt for our Black communities and for our brothers and sisters of color and what they're experiencing right now. We pray against racism and prejudice and hate that's spilling over into our streets. We pray, Lord, for justice and for mercy. We pray for unity. Lord, we pray for your presence right now in our own hearts and our families and our homes and our communities and, Lord, in our nation. We pray that you would unite us together. And Lord, we know that you are the answer. You are the one that we need. So we pray for your presence, and we pray this in your name. Amen. If you're like me, you probably think, so what do I do? How do I respond? Well, this week, Gina and I got on Facebook Live, and we shared our hearts and some of what's been happening inside of us in this journey. And I would encourage you to go and watch that. A friend that I've been learning from shared something with me that this is a time for us to lament, which a lament is a prayer of pain and a prayer of hurt. And this is a time for that. But it's also a time for us to listen with openness. And in that listening, to seek and to learn and to understand. And then out of that is our acts of love in ways that reflect the love and the heart and the compassion of God. There's been a verse that has been guiding me over this past season, and it's Micah 6:8. And here's what it says. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, right? We're asking, what do we do in this? Well, here, God's going to tell us, here's what we do. We do justice, we love kindness, and we walk humbly with our God. To do justice means we also stand against injustice, and we work towards restoring fairness and trust and dignity and respect. We respond in kindness and in grace, and then we humble ourselves and we seek Jesus, his wisdom, his clear direction. Which means we lower our pride, our own ideologies, our own preferences, and we humble ourselves to God first and then to one another. You know, if you'd like to listen and learn more about what the Bible says and God's heart about mercy and injustice in unity, I want to challenge you to go to our website and click on the reading plans and Bible study for some incredible resources from trusted Christian leaders like Tony Evans, Eric Mason, and Dr. Bernice King, and others as well. But I want you to hear this. At New Life, we are committed to ensuring that we will be a multiracial faith family, and that we would seek God together, and that we would pray together, and we would work together for justice and peace and unity. So we're going to take some time today in worship, in communion, and teaching, so that we can learn to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God. Will you join me?
Hello, New Life family. I want to invite you to join with us and worship our God, because He's worthy to be praised. Let's do that.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fail are never enough. And you came along and you put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing. Show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. Because the God of the mountains is the God of the valley. There's not a place where your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Well, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Like a rushing wind, would you breathe within my heart? Through the raging storm, would you hold me in your arms? Cause I need you. I can hear you call my name.
Hey, Eli, thank you so much for leading us in that song, Closer. There's something so powerful in that, that Jesus invites us closer. And I tell you, during a time and a season where there's so much that is just rolling around us, so much that is capturing our hearts and our emotions and challenging us, to know that, Jesus says, lean in. Come closer. And our response saying, I need your love more than I need breath and water and all those things. It's so true. And in this moment that we're going to pause right now just to remember what Christ has done and his invitation to come closer through what he did on the cross is this moment of communion for us. And during a crazy time, this moment that we have this in common. This unites us, that Jesus is our focus. He is the center of everything. And so this moment right here is when we pause and remember that.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that we've been saying a lot around here over the last few weeks is that Jesus is inviting us into something. And I can't help but think during the first communion that we would call it now, the Passover meal. That's what Jesus was doing with his disciples. He was inviting them into something new, a new promise, a new covenant, a new way of coming to the Father, going through him. And so all of this is just a symbol of that. And we can look around our country and see that we are in a season of new way of doing capital C church and a new way of gathering and all these other new things. And so I think in this moment, 2,000 years later, Jesus is still inviting us into the new.
Yeah. And you think about when they gathered together and that Passover meal and Jesus brought them in. There was a lot that was rolling around, a lot that would have caused anxiety and stress, and I'm sure emotions were high. Remember, this is hours before the cross. But Jesus sits them down and says, I want you to experience peace in me. And so I want you to get your bread and your cup ready, because just as Jesus gathered them together, we are gathering together in homes all across our region here. And so I want you to take the bread right now. And just as Jesus took the bread, he broke it and said, this is my body that's broken for you. Let's take and eat together.
And in the same manner, Jesus picked up his cup of wine and he said, this is a symbol of my blood. Every time that you drink this, remember the blood that is coming from my body, pouring from my body, that is covering your sin forever. No more do we have to bring sacrifices in and shed their blood, because the ultimate sacrifice was paid on the cross through Jesus Christ. Let's drink.
Would you pray with me? Jesus, thank you so much for your overwhelming love. Thank you for your invitation for us to come closer, to know you and to experience you, not just as a religious leader, but as our Savior, and as your word says, as our friend. Thank you for your sacrifice of your body and your blood that, as Jeremy said, it covers our sin. There's no trying to earn it or be good enough or jump through enough hoops, but by your grace and your sacrifice, you have invited us closer. And we thank you for that. I pray that you'd continue to bring healing to each of us in our spirits. I pray that you'd bring healing to our emotions, and you'd bring healing, Lord, to our communities, and you'd bring healing to our land. God, that is our prayer, and we thank you for this moment to pause and to remember that it's all about you. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, let's continue to worship. Christ. Hallelujah.
King's returning. When heaven breaks in glorious light, and with him we will reign forever. Oh, praise the name of Jesus Christ.
Chosen me, your love
truth that we are your children. Lord, that you knew us even before we were born. And you watched as we were being knit together as babies. And you knew the steps you had for us. What an amazing thing that you love us so much. You know every hair on our head. You are a big and an amazing God who loves us. We thank you for that, and we praise you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thanks so much, New Life family, for worshiping with us. Now let's hear the message.
Well, happy weekend, New Life family. Thank you so much for joining us again this weekend from wherever you are watching from, whether it's from your bedroom or your living room, or maybe even you're on break at work and you have a chance to watch us. We just want to say thank you so much for joining us this weekend. Also, thank you for Pastor Eli leading us in worshiping God through music. And also, thank you for joining us as we got to agree together as believers during communion. I know that's a really special time for us here at New Life, and we hope that's been special for you as well. Well, go ahead and take out your phones wherever you are and text someone that you've been really missing over the last 10 to 13 weeks, however long we've been able not to gather. And just text them and say, hey, I have spirit. Yes, I do. I have spirit. How about you? All right. See if you can get kind of into a texting war with someone that you love being with on Sunday mornings. Also, don't forget about all the resources that we have available for you every single week, Monday through Saturday. We've got resources online. Just go to newlifecc.com, and we have resources for kids and students and life groups and discipleship. We've got all those things on there, so make sure you take advantage of that. Thank you, all of you who are downloading those. If you have any prayer needs in your life, you can continue to text the word prayers to 30500. And lastly, thank you. We say this each and every week. We never want this to become white noise. Thank you for your faithfulness and your generosity, because we could not do this without you. It is truly a heart condition of being a giver, of being a faithful giver to God through New Life. And we just want to say thank you. So whether you do that online, which is the most popular way to give, or you mail those in to Turlock P.O. Box 782, we just want to say thank you so much for your faithfulness. Well, over the last several weeks, we have been deeply engaged in this new series called What the World Needs Now, and we're dissecting the fruit of the Spirit. We've talked about love and joy and peace and patience, and then last week, we talked about kindness, which really couldn't come at a better time in our country right now. But we're hitting the pause button because we believe that Pastor Dave has a message that God has put on his heart for our church, about our future, about a direction, and really about where we are and the footprint that we can continue to leave in our community with what's happening in our world. So right before Pastor Dave comes, will you just bow your heads wherever you are, and let's pray over the message and over our pastor, Pastor Dave. Father, thank you so much for this message. Lord, as we hit pause on this series, we just pray that you will just speak your words through your servant, Pastor Dave, to your people. And Father, may we embrace the direction and the vision that you have for us in this season of our church. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, at this time, let's welcome Pastor Dave.
Thanks, Jeremy. I appreciate that. As Jeremy said, this is kind of a one-week break from our series. And just a chance for me to just share my heart with you during this really crazy time, this challenging time for us, but also to think about this coming season and what God has for us and what he's leading us into. And I will tell you honestly, my prayer in all of this is that as you hear these words, it would feed your hope. That it wouldn't be just, oh, this is a hard time, but it truly would feed something deep within you. You know, when we kicked off 2020, I don't think any of us could have imagined what we're facing right now. In fact, on January 11th, we started a brand new series called 2020 Vision. I actually printed out the very first message of that series just this last week, and I read through it. Ended up just throwing it in the trash, thinking, man, what in the world happened? Now, the underlying premise of that is still true. It was about us getting a clear vision, God's heart and God's vision for our lives and for our church and for our future. And our key verse was in Psalm 119. And King David wrote these words. He said, "Let me, your servant, walk in abundance of life, that I may always live to obey your truth. Open my eyes to see the miracle wonders that are hidden in your word." And we focused on a couple of those phrases, like abundance of life. And as we look back over these past months, these past weeks, these past days, we think, man, where is this abundance of life? It seems like it kind of got stripped away from us. And it talks about opening our eyes to see the miracle wonders. And yeah, it's hard right now to capture some miracle wonders. But the truth is, we still have a choice every single day, whether to see and walk in God's vision, his purpose, his design, his plan for us, or to choose our way. And maybe it's a way of self-protection. Maybe it's a way of selfishness. Maybe it's just staying in a stuck place. We can choose both of those things. But know this, that God's way always brings to us life and peace and direction, joy, and a deepening friendship with him. That's what it brings. But wow, I never thought that in January that we would be where we are today around a whole host of issues, right? But I want to just step back for a moment in terms of the pandemic and what's happened in the church to just answer this. So where are we today? Because we still keep asking that question, when are we going to kind of come back together again? So in case you don't know this, just in the last week or two, our governor and then our county adopted the governor's plan for opening churches. And so here's what it is. As we sit today, churches are able to open, but with severe guidelines in place to kind of prevent the spread of COVID-19. That's a really good thing. We want to kind of clamp down on that and stop it. Here's what you need to know. We have over 60 pages of kind of guidance and guidelines encompassing 8 different authorities that we have to begin to put in place. Challenging. Now, in that, we know that we're not going to be able to have children's or youth programs that are live on our campus. There's going to be a lot of disinfecting that goes on. That's really good things. So kind of touch-free things like offerings. We're going to have to do physical distancing. Masks are strongly being recommended. In fact, the guidance is strongly encouraging churches not to sing together because of the breath and the spread of moisture droplets. And the truth is, I've seen some of you sing, and so I know there's a lot of moisture, a lot of spit going on there, and they're trying to kind of curtail that. But I know for me, it just doesn't seem like church, doesn't seem like a gathering if we have to kind of set all these things to the side. And the one that's especially challenging is they said only 25% of your capacity can be used, which the truth is, we could probably work with that. But then they said, or 100 people, whichever is less. And by the way, that includes everyone, not just people that are attending. It would be staff and worship team and our sound and tech people, the people who are going to clean and disinfect areas of our church, volunteers and ushers, people who are here for safety. It includes all of that. And so even at the best, it would be allowing about 60 or 70 people max to actually come and attend a service. So even if we used our current worship center, the new one, and our old worship center, we would need close to 20 services to accommodate our church family. Now, I got to tell you, I'm excited to get back together live. I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to seeing faces. I'm looking forward to worshiping together. But after a lot of prayer and conversation and walking through what it's going to take, we realize that under those conditions, it's unworkable for us. And the truth is that we would all be highly disappointed because it wouldn't feel like us. It wouldn't feel like a gathering. And so we've decided to wait during this time. Now, there's going to be some guidelines in this, and after 21 days, they're going to reevaluate. And so we're seeing what the next steps are. But here's what I want to share with you today. And this is, I guess, part of the why behind this is it's really easy to feel like we're just marking time, but God has something for us. He's inviting us into something today, right now, right here in this season. We're not hoping for something else. Right here, He wants to do something. I've been meeting with a group of pastors in Turlock over these last several weeks, just around this piece of regathering in person. And some of those churches are going to be opening. Some of them already have opened and gathered back together. And some, like us, are not able to do that yet. But here's what I want you to know. We don't resent that some can open already. In fact, we are celebrating with our sister churches because we are the church together. And that's a great thing to walk in unity and encouragement together. So we're cheering on each church through this challenging time, knowing that our regathering is coming as well. But still, I could never have imagined that we'd face the things that we're wrestling with, like reopening and pandemic, and also some of the issues around race and some of the challenges that our cities and communities are in right now. That's where we're at. But I want you to know this, is that God hasn't abandoned us in this. He's inviting us into something more, something for here and now. And I have to tell you, it's good. It's pain working through it. It's challenging working through it. But He's got something good for us. It may feel, though, at times, like it's just out of control. Now, I know some of you listening are parents. We have our four kids. But I remember when our kids were small, there were times that as a parent, you had to go use the restroom or you had to run into the garage to grab something off a shelf. And your kids were maybe watching TV, maybe doing homework, whatever it is. And you come back, I mean, 2 or 3 minutes later, and they're just destroying the house. Ever had that happen? And you walk in as a parent and you go, what in the world is going on? And you start pointing at your kids. Did you start this? Is this you? Who's going to clean this up? We just feel like in a matter of moments, everything fell apart. Well, you may feel that's kind of what's happening with God. That maybe God's looking at our world going, hold on here. What happened? I turned my back for a moment and everything's fallen apart. But the reality is that God isn't surprised by any of this. If He is at work in this time and place, what does He desire and what does He want us to learn? And how does He want us to grow during a time and a season that's challenging? In February of 2014, so just over 6 years ago, I spent some time processing through all that God was doing, what He was teaching me personally, and how He was pouring into my life. And I began to write just some scribbles and thoughts. And it was just for me. It was God kind of clarifying some things in me. Later, I shared this with our lead team and then our staff. And ultimately, if you've been around here for a number of years, you're going to recognize this. I shared it with our entire church family. And it's called Imagine a Church. And you need to know that this didn't start with a title like that. It didn't even start with this word imagine. It was scribbles and thoughts and impressions by the Holy Spirit. And over a period of time, it began to coalesce around this idea of imagining what the church could be, imagining what this church could be. And so I want to read just a few of these. The original was longer than this, but I've kind of narrowed it down because I got it out a few weeks ago and it really challenged me with what God had given us those 6 years ago. So listen to these words and see in your mind and in your heart what this is. Imagine a church where each person can live and experience freedom, true freedom that allows us to be all that God intended us to be. Imagine a church where love and grace are lived out. In fact, love and grace become the cornerstone of all that we do. Imagine a church where kids are learning the Bible, loving Jesus, and living it out because they're not the church to come, but they're the church of right now. Imagine a church where students are growing confident in their faith and they know and understand the Bible and they live pure and committed lives. They're not driven by culture, but instead are the beginning of a spiritual revolution that changes schools and changes our community. Imagine a church made up of small groups of believers growing in their knowledge of Christ and living it out in everyday life. These little families become the true place of connection and friendship and accountability. Imagine a church where compassion for the hurting and for those that are broken runs so deep that we will do whatever it takes to meet needs in Jesus' name. Imagine a church where generosity would flow and unleash resources to further God's kingdom. Imagine a church placed on the edge of a freeway, being a visible lighthouse to all who pass by. And then, now I want you to catch this, and then plant outposts of light everywhere in the community and in the region and beyond. Imagine a church where we would never lose who we're called to be to a program or a performance, but we would choose in every situation to be real, personal, and authentic. And last, imagine a church where we would never forget the lost, would never get so caught up in the mechanics of all this that we forget those that are far from God. Now, I got that out a couple weeks ago, and I read through it again, and I just shook my head and thought, 6 years ago, God was preparing us for a season and a time and kind of clarifying who he'd called us to be. And I read it again and thought, maybe God was, yes, doing it for 6 years ago, but maybe God was preparing me and preparing you and our faith family for such a time as this, for right here and for right now, to be his people and his church in this season, not just to attend a gathering, but to truly engage in his kingdom, not just to sit back, but to actually step up. So I want to share a few things with you that I believe are fundamental for us to understand in this new season of what we're entering into. So write this down. The first is that I am God's child. I am God's child. All through the Bible, God called people away to come and experience him in a new way, to grow, to learn, to be established. And you can go through all the names, Abraham and Elijah and David and Paul and Jesus and so many more, all through Scripture. They would come and get away to understand who they were and who God had made them to be. Jesus would pull away from the crowds to spend time with the Father. And the Bible would use this phrase from God to his people. And it was this phrase, come away with me, come away with me. Do you realize that over these past few months that's actually been what God has been doing? He's said, come away with me. Come, step away from all of the busyness and all the stuff that's going on and experiencing me. And why would he do that? Why would he say, hey, come spend this time? It's because he wants us and he loves us. He wants to quiet the voices that rage around us and the insecurities and the fear that well up within us. For us to begin to understand, maybe in ways we never have before, who we really are in him. That I am God's child, that I am his son or his daughter. That you are God's child, that you are his son, that you are his daughter. And you may say, well, what about this and my past or, you know, these areas or all of that gets swept aside because he says, you are mine. I've made you and created you. In 1 John 3, it says this, see how very much our Father loves us, for he calls us his children. And that is what we are. I am chosen. I'm accepted. You are chosen. You are accepted. You are valuable. You are precious. You are seen. You are heard. You matter. But I'll tell you, coming to terms with that doesn't happen in a moment. It's just not the snap of a finger. It happens over time and through circumstances, even circumstances that are painful and hard. So here's what I want to challenge you with. Don't shortchange the long work of God in you. We can come to situations and go, I'm just so tired of this. I'm just so done with this. But God is doing a longer work in you and me. And don't impatiently miss what he wants to do right now. Even in your discomfort, even in my discomfort, even when I'm not sure, like, how do I respond or what do I do or what's the next step? Live in that moment because God is doing a work in that. Think about it this way. I know probably all of us have had a barbecue, and imagine having some chicken that you marinate, and man, you just let it in that sauce, and then you finally put it on the barbecue, and it looks so good, and you are super hungry. And so you let it just keep grilling and you're getting the brown lines, you know, from your barbecue, and the sauce is starting to caramelize and it smells so good. And I know some of you want to pause this right now and go eat, but just hang with me for a moment. And you're looking at it thinking, it must be right. It must be good. It smells so good. And then you just say, you know what? Just take it off the grill because I am done waiting. I'm too hungry. And you never check the inside. You never check the temperature. You never take one and sample it. And so you're just done. You're tired of waiting. So you slice into it and you find out that it's still reddish pink and that chicken is still uncooked on the inside. And it's like, ugh. See, we often rush away from God's presence and his invitation in our impatience because we just want to move on. We just want to get past. And God is saying, hold on, lean in, and trust my timing. You are not marking time right now. God is in this moment. Think about the guidelines they've given for churches, this 100-person limit that has really become an unworkable thing for us and for many other churches. But do you know this? It doesn't surprise God. He's actually allowed it. So let's not miss what God wants to do. He's allowed a pause in all of our busyness so that we can lean into him, we can learn from him, and maybe begin to grasp in a new way our identity as God's sons and daughters. Write this down for number two. I am God's church. I know that's kind of a weird statement, but think about it this way. If the first point we looked at, that I am God's child, that defines who I am individually, God's church defines who we are together. Now, when you think of church, I'm not sure what comes to mind, but if you were to go out in public, if you were to go into a Starbucks and just yell, church, by the way, don't do that right now because you'd probably spit on people unless you have a mask. You know, it's just not going to go over well. But if you were to do something just kind of crazy like that, what would people think other than that it's weird, right? If they really thought, like, what is church? If you did a survey, people would think religion, and they would think liturgy. They'd think all those things, but mostly people would go, it's that temple, it's that cathedral. If someone was, you know, here in Turlock, they might look over at this building and say, well, that's a church right over there. They're going to point to a place. But the Bible gives a different definition of that. And if you've been around New Life for a while, I've talked about this quite a bit. But the word that's used for church in the Bible is a Greek word, and it's the word ekklesia. And now you can throw that around and look impressive, but you know what that word actually means? It means the called out people. The people who God has called out to live in the power of the Holy Spirit to change the world. Simply, the church is people. It's us. It's you and me coming from all different places and backgrounds and ethnicities and socioeconomic positions and careers. I mean, we're all so diverse. We're all so different. And God calls us as his people to be the church. Not just to go to a building and sit in chairs and attend something and listen to someone speak, but to go by the power of the Holy Spirit and to build his kingdom here, right where you live and you work and you go to school and you buy your groceries. Jesus had this encounter with Peter, one of his disciples, and he was calling him into something that Peter couldn't quite understand yet. And he was challenging him in that. And finally, he said this in Matthew 16, 18. He said, now I say to you that you are Peter. Now, that may not seem like a change to you, but he was known as Simon. And so Peter was this change, and it was kind of this play on words. The verse goes on to say, and upon this rock I will build my church. And it was kind of this double meaning kind of thing, because Peter's name now means rock. And he's saying, on you, Peter, I'm going to do something new in building this church. And he says then this, and all the powers of hell will not conquer it. We are the called out people of God, built on the rock, not Peter the rock, but on the rock of Jesus Christ. And he says, not even the power of hell can stop it. And I want you to hear this. I want you to hear this. The government can't stop it. And county guidelines can't stop it. And protests can't stop it. Shelter in place orders can't stop it. The church, God's people, is unstoppable. And it only took us about 300 years to kind of mess that up. Because what people began to think of when they heard the word church was not the called out people, they began to see it as God's house, and it became a building, a place, a structure. Now, we understand from the Old Testament and the temple that there was some background for that, but Jesus had changed all that. He called us into something new. Now, I know that many of you are anxiously waiting to get back to this place called church, and we will get there. And we will get there. And it's going to be exciting to see. I'm looking forward to it. But don't ever get mixed up on what church really is. It's you and it's me, called out and empowered by God. And I know it's convenient and maybe easy to focus on what we can't do right now. I can't do this and I can't do that. I can't just get back to normal. I can't just go into any restaurant and sit anywhere that I want. I can't go to the movies right now. I can't go to the gym. I can't go to a ball game. I can't sneeze on people, which was never a good thing to do. But here's the big one. I can't gather with my church. All of the can'ts make us weary, make us tired, make us frustrated, maybe even make us angry. But God has something in this. So our family numerous times has gone to Santa Cruz. Growing up, my dad loved Santa Cruz, and so we would go there, and now my family will go there every once in a while. I love to take our bikes there and ride along. And there's a place called Lighthouse Point. It's where the surfing museum is, and it looks across over to the boardwalk and the wharf and people surfing, all those things there. Now imagine that you were there with me, and you walked out to this point, and it's a cliff, and it's, I don't know, 60, 70 feet down to the water. It's quite a big thing. And they have a railing there. But imagine that we were sitting there together and you walked up and you went, oh, I can't believe they have this railing here. I can't believe that they're not letting me kind of go out there and see. I mean, what do they think I'm going to do? Fall over? Do they think I'm just going to jump off there? What do they actually think that I'm going to do? I can handle myself. And you think all these restrictions are keeping me from what I really want to do. And if we walked away from that, and if I turned to you and said, hey, when we were there, did you notice the ocean? Did you notice the waves that were coming in and the tide that was rising? Did you notice the otters playing in the kelp? Did you see the cloud formations and the birds? And maybe you'd go, no, I was too busy being frustrated with the railing. I was too busy being frustrated and preoccupied with all that I couldn't do that I missed what I could do. I was so preoccupied with what I couldn't see and experience that I missed what I could see and what I could experience. See, what God wants to do in you and in me together isn't limited by what the government says or decrees. In the series that we've been in called What the World Needs Now, we've used this passage from Galatians, and we've talked about the fruit and the flavors that are associated with that. And I want to read you this passage because the end of it is, we haven't been glossing over it, but we've been focusing on these nine characteristics that says this, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. We go, wow, those are such hard, challenging, but really good things we want to have in our life. But sometimes these last few words just kind of slide right on by. But look what it says. There is no law against these things. There's nothing that's holding us back from being people of love. There's no law against being a person of love. There's no law against being a person who lives in joy. There's no law against being a person who is patient. There's no law against a person to respond in kindness. Not one thing is holding us back from being God's sons and daughters. Not one thing is holding us back from being His people right where we are in the circumstances that we find ourselves. The Bible says that God is present in a unique way, even when a couple of us gather in His name. He's with us. We are His church. So let me go back to this whole regathering thing. If you've been listening over these past weeks or you've caught us during the middle of the week, we've talked about three lanes that we're going to be moving into in this coming season. And the first lane is new life at home. And it's to continue what we're doing right now. It's watching online. And I know it can get tiring at times, but maybe you can have a new perspective on that. And there's nothing more spiritual than this lane or any other lane. They're all equal. It just may be where God has you right now. The second lane is new life with friends. And I think this could be one of the greatest opportunities that we have right now, because maybe you're ready to move out of just shelter in place and shelter at home. And maybe, my guess is you're probably already doing it. You've probably had some friends over. You maybe have gone to a friend's house. Maybe just there's another family, another couple that you're comfortable with already, and you've already began some interacting and some friendship. What if you were the church together? What if you met in one of your homes? And yes, you're going to be safe, and you're going to be, you know, disinfecting things and all the safe things we need to do. But what if that just became an option for us to take another step to make an impact that way? Now, the truth is that the third lane, the new life live, when we come and gather back together, that lane is closed and under construction right now, to continue the metaphor of a highway. We can't drive down that lane right now. But is it possible that when we imagine a church as an outpost of light, that that light may be your front porch light? It might be your friend's house. I mean, I think of 6 years ago when we looked at that, of church and then these outposts of light, that's our homes. That's what we're doing right now. God already knew and was putting that in place. So the question is, what are the opportunities for friends and family? Who is it that's your neighbor that you could be praying for? Who's the coworker that's struggling? Who's the student from a class that you're on, you know, on Zoom with that seems detached and lonely? How could you be the church? Because see, God's using every one of us in this. It's not just a few, but all of us are the church. All of us have a part to play. All of us are engaging in this, not just attending, not just watching, but engaging. Because I am the church and you are the church. And God wants to do something in that. Let me give you this last one. God is at work all around, and he's inviting me to join him. God is at work all around, and he's inviting you to join him. So we've taken some road trips with our kids. I remember going up to Oregon one time, and we were going up to the coast with some family. And you know, if you've ever been in a car ride with kids, even some adults, maybe it's even when you were a kid. What's the phrase that we use more than any other we hear from our kids, right? Are we there yet? Or as someone told me when I asked them, it's where's the next bathroom stop? So one of those two phrases. But the are we there yet? Are we there yet? We say that over and over and over again. And I remember driving up to Oregon, and we were going on I-5, which in Northern California just gets... it's not the prettiest location of all, just big kind of fields, and it was dry because it was summertime. And you come around the corner, if you've ever done this, and you see Mount Shasta. Doesn't matter what time of year, there's still snow on it, and it's right there in your windshield. It's just huge. And so I'm telling my kids, now they were younger, there were no phones that they were holding on at this time, but they had books and games and stuff. I said, look, and they kind of give the, yeah, well, you know, whatever. And then the question, are we there yet? And all I'm thinking is, are we there yet? You keep waiting for where we're going, but look what's going on around you. They were missing the beauty and the landmarks and the creation. They were waiting for something, but this is right here, right now. What if each morning when we got up, we prayed, God, show me where you're at work today. Not what's coming, not a someday. Let me see where you're at work today, and let my eyes see and my heart feel where you're moving. Maybe there's something that I need to engage with today, maybe a conversation. Maybe, Lord, today where you're working is an opportunity for me to listen and to empathize and to hear. Maybe today you're inviting me into a moment to extend grace. Maybe today you're inviting me into a chance to deeply love someone or to serve someone, to open my eyes to see, and then for us to be grateful for the invitation to come join you. What if that was every day for us? I don't want to miss out on what God is doing right now and what he's inviting us into. Jesus said this in Matthew 5, and I'm almost done. But he said this, here's another way to put it. You're here to be light, bringing out the God colors in the world. Isn't that beautiful? God's not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under a bucket, do you? I'm putting you on a light stand. And now that I've put you there on a hilltop, on a light stand, shine. Keep open house. Be generous with your lives. And by opening up to others, you'll prompt people to open up with God, this generous Father in heaven. So you don't have to just be an observer, but you are invited to fully participate in God's plan to bring light and hope and life to our world. Not someday, not when we can finally regather, not when everything in culture is just smooth, but right now when it's hard, right now when it's challenging, a chance to listen, a chance to respond, a chance to be God's hands and feet. Remember those early passages in the New Testament where Jesus is calling his disciples to follow him? He's still calling disciples. He's still calling followers, and it's me and it's you. And we're not simply accepting this season where we are. We're embracing the new that God has for us, accepting his invitation to join him. Would you pray with me? Father, right now, we're grateful for this time we're in, as challenging and as hard as it is, because you're in this. And you're inviting us to join you in the work that you're already doing, bringing friendship, bringing reconciliation, bringing hope, bringing life, bringing love and grace and kindness. Lord, I pray we wouldn't miss those things. I pray we wouldn't skip over them, trying to get to the next thing, trying to just move past this, but right now, right here, to just follow you, to trust you, and to know that you really are the hope of the world. So Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for our church family. Thank you for the unity that we have, even though we're in different little outposts of light all through our community and beyond. Lord, I pray that you would unite us in heart and in spirit. We pray for those who are hurting today. We pray for those who are saddened and wounded. Lord, today we do lament. Our hearts break for what is going on. And I pray, Lord, we could listen. I pray, Lord, we could love. I pray, Lord, we could learn. Lord, give us hearts to follow after you. We thank you. We love you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, thanks for joining us today for this online service. And I want to just challenge you as we end this to go in God's grace, to go in God's love. Know that you are valuable, that you are precious, that his smile is on you. And he's calling you and inviting you to join him in the work that he's doing right now. So be blessed and be a blessing.
Yeah, mine was 2. I just turned it down. I'm at 2.2 ISO. It's because the lower.